Hello students, so the solid state is almost completed, okay? Only two videos are left. So in today's video, we are going to discuss about electrical properties of the solid, okay? And in our next video, we will discuss about the magnetic properties of solid. So the solid state, already we have discussed about the solid state, their crystals. So just the remaining part is their properties. In our today's class, we will discuss about electrical properties. Clear? So first, in the board, you can see one classification. Okay, so just note it down in your copy, the classification. So I am just explaining the classification. The first part is conductor. Okay, the first part you can see on the board, the first type of solid is conductor. Next type you can see, that is insulator. And the third type you can see, that is semiconductor. Okay, so first we will learn about conductors and then we will go to the next two parts. So what are conductors? So from your lower classes, already you have learned about the conductors. Conductors are the substances which can pass electricity or which can pass electric current very easily through them, right? Conductors can pass electric current very easily through them. So these are called conductors. Now there are two types of conductors. The first one is metallic and the second one is electrolytic. So what are metallic conductors and what are electrolytic conductors? So in case of metallic conductors, so these are normally different types of metals. Okay, these are normally different types of metals which has free electrons in it. Just like suppose there is a metal M. So the metal, it can eject one or more electron from it. Okay, the metal that can eject one or more electron, therefore I have written N number of electron. Okay, it can eject means remove. It can remove one or more electrons from the atom. After removing the electrons, it will make a cation, and the electrons that now can easily move through the surface of the metal, through the surface of the metal there are many free electrons present there. At the surface of the metal, there are many electrons, free electrons basically present there, which can, these free electrons can now conduct electricity by moving from one place to another place. As they are charged particles, so they can conduct electricity. So the first type of conductor are metals, and that can conduct electricity without any chemical change between them, because the metals, they are making here the cation. Now the cation can again accept the electrons to make the metal again. So that reaction could be reversible in nature. Okay, that could be reversible in nature. So therefore, no such type chemical change is taking place here. So this is the first type, that is the metallic conductor. Next one is electrolytic. Electrolytic also you have learned that different type of electrolysis process. Electrolysis means what? Whenever a chemical substance we have taken, okay, and that chemical substance, it will undergo a chemical change. That means it will undergo a chemical dissociation to make the ions. Just like NaCl in aqueous solution, okay, sodium chloride in solid state cannot, sodium chloride in the solid form cannot conduct electricity, but whenever it is dissolved in the water, that means whenever it is in the aqueous solution, then it can form two ions, Na plus and Cl minus. Now these charged particles that are present in water, now they can conduct electricity easily by moving, by their movement. Okay, so electrolytic conductors are those conductors which undergo a chemical change, because here we can see the chemical dissociation. Dissociation means breaking of the compound. sodium chloride is dissociated here to make these two ions Na plus and Cl minus. So chemical dissociation will take place to undergo the or to conduct the electric current. So this type of compounds, this type of salts are called electrolytes, right? Already you are familiar with the name electrolytes, L-Y-T-E-S, electrolytes. So that's why this type of conductors are called electrolytic conductors. Clear? So these are the two types of conductors. Next is insulator. So insulator are the substances which cannot conduct electricity. Okay, insulators are the substances which have no free particles in it, and that's why, either they have free particles also, but some barrier is there, okay, just to conduct electricity. So that's why for some reason they cannot conduct electricity. So the examples are just like wood, okay, sulfur, glass, plastic. So these all are the examples of insulators. Okay, and the last one, that is semiconductor. So semi means what? Semi means half. So that means their conductivity level is just in between the conductor and the insulator. That means they are not a very good conductor of electricity as well as not a very bad conductor also. So they are having their conductivity value in between insulators and conductors. So that's why they are called semiconductors. So what are the examples of semiconductors? So semiconductors are having the example like silicon, germanium, okay. So this type of elements can act as the semiconductor. Now the semiconductor has also two parts. One is intrinsic, another one is extrinsic. Intrinsic means pure, that means pure germanium. Just like semiconductor means this one, silicon or germanium, these elements can act as semiconductor. Pure means pure silicon or pure germanium. That means in that substance only silicon atoms will be there, only germanium atoms will be there. So they are intrinsic or pure semiconductor, but their conductivity is low. Okay, they are at room temperature. If we measure their conductivity level, so their conductivity is low. And in case of extrinsic means impure. That means in pure germanium or in pure silicon, some extra impurities or some other elements are added in it as impurity just to enhance its conductivity level or just to increase the conductivity value. Okay, so depending on the impurities that are added in the intrinsic semiconductor, it can be classified into two types. One is n-type semiconductor, another one is p-type semiconductor. So in our in today's class we will also discuss these two types. So first, what you have to do, you have to just copy this chart. Okay, so first, now I will describe their conductivity level in terms of band theory. Okay, in terms of band theory. And first you have to know what is their conductivity value actually. So for the metals, the conductivity value is in the range of 10 to the power 8 for conductors. It is in the value of 10 to the power 8 ohm inverse meter inverse. Okay, for conductors the value is in this range for metallic mainly. This is the value, 10 to the power 8. For electrolytic, the value is in the range 10 to the power 22, 10 to the power minus 10 ohm inverse meter inverse. Okay, for insulator the value is, this is a bit 10 to the power 8 is for conductors. Okay, now 10 to the power minus 20. Minus 20 means the very low. So that will be for insulator. 10 to the power minus 20 to 10 to the power minus 10 ohm inverse meter inverse. this value is for the insulator, and for the semiconductor, the value lies in the range of 10 to the power minus 7 to 10 to the power 4. 10 to the power minus 7 to 10 to the power 4, in this range, the conductivity of the semiconductor lies. Okay, and the unit is always ohm inverse, meter inverse. Next. So now we will explain their conductivity in terms of band theory. Okay. So first I am describing for metals. So explaining their conductivity level by using band theory. So for metals. So few metals are there, okay, few metals are there, just like lithium, sodium. So they are having their valence band, that is, valence band means their valence orbital, just like suppose lithium. Lithium having atomic number 3. So that means 1s2, 2s1. So you can see that 2s1 means this orbital is half filled, right? This is not completely filled here, this is half filled. Another example, sodium. Sodium having 11 electrons, 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s1. So again, this is half filled. So in this case, the orbital that is containing the valence electron, okay, the orbital that is containing the valence electron and the band that is representing their electrons in terms of energy, that is called valence band. So this is the valence band for it, valence band for metals like lithium or sodium in terms of energy. So energy rises in this direction, okay. So this is the valence band. Band means what? What? Band means actually that is representing their energy value, okay. This one, this band representing the energy of their valence orbital. So now this is half filled, okay. So now the orbital, that is the orbital, just my next orbital, just suppose there is 3p, there is 2p. So this is what? This is vacant. This is also vacant, vacant higher orbitals, right? Vacant higher orbitals. So above this, just removing this. So above the valence band, this is for, suppose I am drawing for lithium. So this is for 2s. If this is for lithium, this is for 2s, and the upper one, this is for 2p, right? 2p is vacant totally. 2p is totally vacant. So it is having 0 electrons. 2p is totally vacant. So it is having 0 electrons. So now the energy gap between them is low. The energy gap between the valence band, that is, this is the energy gap between them. The energy gap is low. So easily the electrons from the lower energy level, the lower valence band, can easily move to the upper vacant band. So therefore, this type of metals can conduct electricity. Next, for the metals like magnesium. Magnesium having how many electrons? 12 electrons magnesium is having. Magnesium is having 12 electrons. That means 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2. So that means the last valence shell of magnesium, that is completely filled. Okay. So now, in case of magnesium, or for such metals which are having the last valence shell totally filled, so this is the valence band and this is the higher energy band. Suppose this is 3s and this is 3p. So in such case where the valence band is completely filled, so it is actually overlapping with the higher energy band. That means with the 3P, it is overlapping. Overlapping means what? There is no energy gap. There is actually no energy gap. Okay? That's why they are overlapping. So, the electrons that are present here, the two electrons that are present here, they can easily now go to the higher energy. This band is also known as conduction band. Okay? So, when you are, one thing I have missed to tell. So, suppose here there is one electron. So, under normal condition, it will not go. For the conduction, you have to apply the electric current here. And then you have to check that whether it is conducting the electricity or not. Right? So, for lithium, you have to apply some electric field from outside. You have to apply some electric current from outside. And then you have to check that whether it conducts electricity or not. So, electric field means what? Electric energy, electrical energy. So, this electron, it will accept the electrical energy and then it will go up to the higher level, right? Because to move from lower level to higher level, it requires some amount of energy. So, from where it will get that energy? From the applying electrical field. From the applying electrical energy, it will get the energy to move up to the higher level. Similar case, this also, when you are applying some electrical energy here, so the electrons that are present in the valence band, it will move to the conduction band. So, by applying electric current, as the electrons can move to the next level or to the conduction band, so that's why these metals can conduct electricity. Clear this one? These are for metals. Next, for insulator and for semiconductor. So, now for insulator. For insulator, suppose this is the valence band, completely filled or half filled, whatever. And this is the conduction band or higher energy band. This is the valence band. And this is the conduction band. So, they are representing the energy of these shells or orbitals. Now, there are supposed two electrons here. Now, you are applying energy, electrical energy from outside. But the gap between the valence band and the conduction band is so high that the electron cannot go easily to the conduction band. Okay? The energy gap should be less than the electrical energy. Suppose you are supplying electrical energy out from outside is E. Okay? And the gap, the energy gap between them is E1. This is the electrical energy you have supplied from outside. And E1 is the energy gap between them. So, if the electron, so what is the condition to move the electron from valence band to, conduction band? That E must be equal to or greater than E1. This should be the condition for conduction of electron, right? This should be the condition for conduction of electron. But here what happens? Here the electrical energy that you have supplied from outside under normal condition, that is less than the energy gap. That is less than the energy gap because the value of energy gap is very high. And because of this, here the electron cannot move from here. The electron cannot move from the valence band to the conduction band. And that's why insulators cannot conduct electricity under the normal condition. But if you increase the temperature or if you increase the amount of electrical energy, in that case, its conductivity increases, but in a very low amount. Okay. Now for semiconductor. Now for semiconductor, the energy gap between them, it is low. The energy gap between them, it is low or almost equal to the energy applied from outside. And that's why the electrons can move from the lower valence shell to the upper conduction band. And that's why the semiconductor can conduct electricity, but the insulators cannot conduct electricity. Okay, but under normal condition, under normal temperature, the conductivity of semiconductors are also very low. Okay, so that's why impurities are added in it, just to increase its conductivity level. Okay, so next I am discussing about different types of semiconductors. Okay, so semiconductors are of two type. One is pure semiconductor and another one is impure semiconductor or intrinsic semiconductor. Already I have discussed today, pure and impure. So pure means, the name is intrinsic, and this is extrinsic. So here only germanium, suppose only germanium atoms are present in the crystal of this semiconductor. Okay, now, so this is pure type. So in case of pure or intrinsic semiconductor, they are having lower value of conductivity. Okay, so their conductivity value is low at room temperature, and their conductivity is almost zero. For pure or intrinsic semiconductor, their conductivity is almost zero at absolute zero temperature. That means at zero Kelvin temperature. Okay, so their conductivity is extremely low. So for increasing their conductivity, impurities are added in pure or intrinsic semiconductor. Okay, and the process by which impurities are added in pure or intrinsic semiconductor, that process is called doping. Okay, the process by which impurities are added to pure or intrinsic semiconductors just to increase its conductivity value, that process is called doping. So depending on the impurities added here, there are two type of semiconductors. So first we will discuss n-type. This is the first type of extrinsic semiconductor, that is n-type. So n means what? N means negative. So the semiconductors where negatively charged electrons conduct electricity, that is known as n-type semiconductors. So how it is possible? So let's see one example. So suppose this is a germanium crystal. Okay, now germanium silicon, which act as pure semiconductor, these all are group 14 elements, right? Germanium silicon, these are actually the pure semiconductor, and these all are group 14 elements. So group 14 means their valence electron number is 4. Number of valence electrons present in the valence shell. Number of electrons present in the valence shell, that is 4. So that's why germanium is sharing 4 electrons here. You can see clearly. Germanium is sharing 4 electrons with the neighboring atoms. All are germanium. So it is making four covalent bonds on its 4 sides, right? Now, in case of n-type semiconductor, you have to add impurity of group 15 element. That means you can add any element from the group 15. So, what are the examples? Example are phosphorus, okay, then arsenic, antimony, bismuth, okay. So, phosphorus, arsenic, antimony, bismuth. So this can be added here in this case. So what will happen now? Now we will see. So phosphorus. So group 15. Group 15 means they are having valence electrons 5. group 15 elements are having valence electrons, 5, okay? So that means they will have 5 electrons outside. Suppose phosphorus is there. So phosphorus is having 5 electrons. Phosphorus is sharing 5 electrons, okay? So now what will happen? Suppose by replacing one germanium with phosphorus, we are getting this impure semiconductor, okay? One germanium is replaced by this phosphorus. So this is the process that is called doping. So now how many electrons phosphorus will have? So this electron, it will make one covalent bond with this germanium. This electron of phosphorus, this will make one covalent bond with this germanium, this two and this two. But one electron that is unused here, that is this electron. This electron, okay, it cannot be used with any germanium because germanium is tetravalent having valency 4, but phosphorus is pentavalent having valency 5. So one electron will remain unused. So that electron, it will act as the free electron, and when you are applying electricity from outside, so this electron can carry the electric current through the semiconductor. Okay, so this negatively charged electron can conduct the electricity through the semiconductor, and that's why it is called n-type semiconductor. So when you are adding group 15 elements, okay, in a very little amount, not a very large amount, you are adding a very little amount of group 15 elements like phosphorus, arsenic, antimony in group 14 elements like germanium or silicon. So then the one electron that will remain unused, that can conduct electricity here, and that's why it is called n-type semiconductor. Clear? Next type of impure semiconductor, that is p-type. So p means positive. So here lack of electron will take place. So the semiconductor or the pure semiconductor, it will remain same, that is germanium or silicon. But here you have to add group 13 elements, okay? Group 13 elements. So group 13 elements means what? Just like boron, aluminium, gallium, okay? This type of elements you have to add here, which are having valence electrons 3, which are having valence electrons 3, okay? So now, suppose aluminium is there. So aluminium will have 3 electrons outside. So now see what will happen. Again, one germanium atom, it is replaced by one aluminium. Now, aluminium has only 3 electrons outside. So this electron it has shared with this germanium, this electron also with this. So 3 covalent bonds are there. But here, due to the lack of electrons, because aluminium can share only 3, because it has 3 electrons. So this, at this place, no electron is there. So there will be created one positive hole. Okay, one positive hole will be created here. So now this positive hole will conduct the electricity. How? Because to fill this positive hole, one electron from another germanium ion, that will come here. One electron from the adjacent germanium, that will come here to fill the positive hole. So when it will come here to fill this place, so here there will be created one vacancy, one positive hole. Now to fill this electron, sorry, now to fill this gap or this vacancy, one electron from the adjacent germanium atom, it will now come here. So there will be created vacancy. So by this way, the holes will move from one side to another side. Okay? And by this way, the electricity will be conducted with the help of this positive holes. So that's why these are called p-type semiconductors. And the next thing is that what are the applications of these semiconductors? So these semiconductors are generally used in different type of transistor, okay? diodes. So there are the uses given in this semiconductors, okay, in transistor as well as in solar cell. For making diodes, this type of semiconductors are used. And what is the effect of temperature? That already I have discussed today, that with increase in temperature, okay, when you are increasing the temperature in case of metals, with increase in temperature, the conductivity decreases, okay? Because suppose in case of metals, there are free electrons, and when you are increasing the temperature, the kinetic energy of the electrons are increasing, so they will move in more random way. So because of their randomness, okay, because of their unstable state, okay, it can resist in the flow of electric current. Because of the random motion of the electrons, it can apply one resistance in a direction opposite to the electric current. So in case of metals, when we are increasing the temperature, electrical conductivity decreases. But in case of a semiconductor, whenever you are increasing the temperature, their conductivity will increase. Because when you are increasing the temperature, the kinetic energy of the free electrons present here, which are present in a small amount, that will increase. So their randomness will also increase, but that will not be increased in a large extent like in case of metals. So it will not hamper the movement of electrical current. And that's why in case of semiconductor, when you are increasing the temperature, their conductance will increase. Okay. So in our next class, we will discuss the magnetic properties of the solid state. Thank you everyone for watching today's video.